welcome to this podcast with a difference within a difference, because we are not just staying on the original location of where we film these podcasts, but we're taking this to the stars. Now, for those of you who don't know, the podcast is actually called Up on the Lookout, and this is a podcast with a difference. Here we like to talk about Dragon Ball and various topics about the series, and today's one is no exception. If you are familiar with the podcast feed, we actually have a series called Revelation F, which has just concluded its first season, and if you haven't had a chance to listen to it, I sincerely wish that you do listen to it, because we not only have something to talk about that show, but we also have some cast members and one of the writers on it as well. So first of all, I would like to say welcome to my regular sidekick, Haverok.
Hello, I'm not perfect, but I'm not fake.
Yes, and joining us today, we have two guests. So normally we're like, like Bardock and DBZA, I'm like, God, we have one, I have one of those. Oh my God, I have two of those. But yes, joining me today are the voices of Julia Gu voices Cheelai.
Hi there, I'm Cheelai and I voice Julia Gu.
Yes, exactly. That's how it is. Nailed it. And of course, our absolutely quintessential Wolfang, Stanpai.
Oh, what's going on, everybody?
Nice, cool. So with myself playing Frieza and Kit, we have four of the five main cast. Philly could not be joining us today. She's got some schoolwork to be getting on. But yeah, we wish that she's here in spirit, because Shiraz would be up to no good or doing some very important computational stuff that could easily destroy the universe if it went wrong. Sorry, what? Oh, yeah. No, probably nothing. But yes, this is a Revelation F special. And it has been a very special journey getting to this point. And it all started with the other production that's been going on in the background. And that, of course, has been Dragon Ball R&R. And that, if you don't know, is the story of What If Raditz Turned Good, but a spin-off. We're currently working on episode 7 right now. We've managed to find some new crew members. We'll be having that be completed relatively soon, hopefully at the end of this year, and then we'll be able to finalize what we want to do with it coming into 2022 and see where we go from there. But Revelation F is definitely something that we love doing in the meantime. But it's not just a wanting to toot our own horns, but Julia and Stan came from that series. And Stan, you reprise your role as Yamcha here. I mean, that's a given here, right?
Yeah.
And Julia pretty much voices any minor in the show, pretty much. As in, like, voices Marin, Daikon and Muli, and Mai. It's just like, and yeah, you do them very well. But Hav and I were actually at that point where we were just like, oh no. Oh, jeez.
No, we are typecasting her. Oh no.
No. We want to give a part that has a bit more substance to it. And ultimately, we managed to just keep you in mind for various things. So you did a very good job with Marin. And yeah, just the endearing thing, the standout thing from episode 4 is when Ranch, Goten, Trunks, they're off. And then Marin's just the, wee! She can't fly at that. No, you nailed that. That was great.
I remember recording that one.
Yeah, no, that was good. But yeah, so let's just say, when you got the call for Revelation F, how have you found it being different from R&R? So, Julia, I'll start with you.
So, if I were to compare it to R&R, I feel like R&R is very much like, almost like sitcom family sort of stuff. Like, it's a lot of familial relationships and exploring those kinds of things, while R&R is more like, I mean, I think you said it yourself, like, it's like a space opera, and it's very much, what is it? Like, everyone going on, like, small misadventures and kind of exploring, I mean, developing characters and relationships along the way.
I mean, that's absolutely it. I mean, the main goal of Revelation F was just to make it kitsch, fun, simple, quick to make, 1950s style radio play, and bringing people over to the delights of a radio play, just because I'd love to animate this, but it would be extremely expensive. But no. I did put a poll, and we will talk about what scene might be animated, but there is a clear favorite.
Ooh.
And Stan, it does involve your character.
So,
but yeah, no, Stan. How's been the experience of playing R&R Yamcha to Revelation F Yamcha?
So one of the things regarding when I got the call, my favorite thing about the R&R episode in particular, where, you know, Yamcha's curveball is the fact that he is such a center figure in this story where he's normally not at all. And I think it's the first time he appears in R&R. So, you know, I came in with this knowledge of, like, you know, this guy is not going to be in every episode, but this is his moment to shine. And I've always been a Yamcha fan. So when the opportunity came up to audition and everything, I audition for more than one part if there's something I feel like I could do a couple of different things. But with that episode, I had just auditioned for Yamcha because I knew what I wanted. And so being able to do that, it was exciting, but it was also like, but I also know this is only going to be in this one episode, basically. And with the exception of, you know, cameos elsewhere in the series, that was the expectation. Do it once, try to hit it out of the park, and then that's the end of the game, right? So when I got the call for the entire space opera that has Yamcha in the crew, one, I was excited because, oh man, Yamcha's back and he gets to be in something recurrent, which is good for me on a personal level. But then also as a fan, I'm excited because Yamcha gets sidelined so hard by the official series that any opportunity for more Yamcha time is always something I'm excited about. And also, you know, following along that what if story as you were developing it, I was very gripped by it. Particularly because it's such a different kind of tale, and it goes to so many different places. So seeing Frieza's journey through all that, and then Yamcha getting to be a part of it, it fits. It's almost like I've been so hooked on the Dragon Quest stuff that having this Dragon Quest party in space has been great, and Yamcha's a part of it. So that's for me just thrilling.
You know what's the funniest part of it? Like, originally, like, we swore we'll never do What If Frieza Turned Good type scenario.
That was very true.
Because we thought we cannot pull it to be, you know, believable and interesting, you know? And not feel contrived in many ways.
Boy, were we wrong.
Yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah.
We were very, very wrong and close-minded.
Oh yeah, it's great.
No, I mean, I was just like, I couldn't believe I actually did it. But hey, I just followed the apparent theory on the channel is that I hate Vegeta. So just hate on Vegeta some more. But I don't really. He's one of the best characters in terms of development. It's just the very early part in Z, he does some really bad, jerky stuff.
Yeah. Most of the positive discussions we have are about Vegeta.
Yeah, exactly. So we're not trying to down on the Prince of Vegetables. We're really not.
I wrote like 3,000 word essay about Vegeta last week. Thank you very much. We don't hate Vegeta.
Habs base work on that, and then when I added to it, you know, kind of we got that complete script. It's a long boy. It took me like 27 minutes to record. It may be like a 25 minute discussion, and yeah, it's a long one, and you'll be all seeing it in a couple of weeks at the time of this recording. So, yeah, have put a lot of grunt work into the initial draft. And then when we just, like, get this to the where it's a video, oh boy, it's going to be a doozy. And it all fit together. It's not just us recalling every single bit of history of Vegeta. There is a point to it, but you'll see it in the video. But, yeah. So, before we continue, I'd actually like to ask you, Julia and Stan, where can people find you? Because I think it's time for an earlier cheeky plug than we normally do. So where can we find y'all?
I am most active on Twitter, at Julia Gu VO. I also occasionally do some Twitch streaming as a VTuber. So that's at SEI_SOU, say so.
Ah, clever, I see what you did there.
Hey!
Typically, if you just look up the word Stanpai, Stanpai, that's the easiest way to find me. I'm most active these days, actually on Newgrounds.com, which is something you don't typically hear, but I'm very, very passionate about that community and doing my part in there. And in fact, you can even catch some episodes of this show on Newgrounds. So keep an eye out for that. Otherwise, YouTube, I'm not as active there anymore. I've been very busy recently. But, you know, again, Stanpai, you look that up, you'll find me. I'm not even very active on Twitter anymore. I pretty much exclusively keep to, you know, what productions I'm working with. And, you know, if you need to get a hold of me, just find a way to give me a shout and maybe I'll appear out of thin air.
You know, yeah, you're very true. The first 5 episodes are indeed on Newgrounds, so I need to upload the rest of them over the next few weeks. But yeah, you can also find Revelation F, by the way, if you're interested. Not just on YouTube, but you can actually get it on Spotify, Apple Music, outside of the podcast stream. So you can actually download the audiobook as an album. And that's been really good. And so far, I've been looking at the stats. And by a long way, episode 2's the most streamed. That's the episode where that's the first like proper mission that Cheelai and Yamcha are on. And they meet the construction crew. So
right on.
Yeah, that's the one where Cheelai makes such the biggest smarmy, like, yeah, turns around the chair. Yo, looking for this?
I've been expecting you, Mr. Bond.
Exactly. Yeah, that's the best thing. And it pretty much just set the tone about how those two are going to operate. Like, initially, it's just going to be Cheelai is just the sneaky. And then just like, you know, Yam's just like, oh my God, I want to wheel him. I'm so bad. I'm really tough. I don't like being abandoned anymore. I don't get to punch people. It's old habits die hard, as
yeah,
it were.
Absolutely. Yeah. And some of the characters also die hard, but thankfully not in this series so far. Oh, no.
Seeing as this is about Revelation F, I'd like to just like to reach out to, well, just to all four of us, really. What's been the standout moment for you all? Not just necessarily your favorite episode, but from what you've seen in comments and just how it's developed. You know, anyone take the floor.
Okay, so I'm the anyone. Okay, so you know, like I had a lot of those. I think like the seeing reactions to episode 12 was my favorite. I didn't pen that one personally, but like you know, we are like kind of going over it together, and I think the sheer reaction to the closing scene with the cliffhanger. I always love to see the audience getting pumped up, and then we cut them with a cliffhanger. Like it's my Schadenfreude, really.
Yeah, admittedly, I was sort of like that too. I was in like, yeah, we just end it where you just get one line of Frigid, who's played by our friend Richard Barcenas, and he voices Piccolo in R&R as well. So I thought, well, let's bring him on because he's got really good range and something that's a little bit different to all the other Frieza clones and stuff. But now he did a really good job. We recorded for him for episode 13. So we got the follow-up episode, which we will hopefully have out sometime in November. I can reveal that to you all right now we're going to have things ready to release season 2 from November. And if I can get a good handle, we can release it weekly, which will be good.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We are elbows deep in developing season 2 scripts.
Yeah.
And not only scripts, more stuff, more about that.
Usually whenever I've been writing stuff, because I actually started back in the day in 2005 making radio plays of like my original content. And I love doing it. And so coming back to this and doing a whole season has been really great. And taking Cheelai, who really didn't have much in the original series, and not making her all about Broly was my big pride and joy moment in the fact that, oh, I did mention about, oh, hey, Broly may not be so bad. And she's just like, eh, maybe. And it just everyone in the comments like, when is she going to shack up with Broly? First off, she's not an adult in this series, first of all. Yeah, because this is like set takes place in age 767. So just after the Cell Games. So I think Cheelai in Broly is like in her late 20s or early 30s or something. That's relatively nothing in the scheme of, you know, time and space and stuff. I mean, yeah, Granola can live for up to 200 years, the Cerulean's. So it's a drop in the bucket in comparison. But to be able to actually go off with no, there's no lore, there's no backstory for Cheelai. So it's like, hey, why don't we just create something that involves Saiyans and includes a sister? Because, hey, we need to have some kind of competition.
At the same time, you know, there are enough of those little quirks and personalities when you can start to wonder, hey, where do these come from, right?
Yeah, no, exactly. Because, you know, Cheelai has a blaster. She's sneaky. She's a thief. So, you know, why don't we just find the place that in the original Frieza What If, she was a street urchin who then, you know, kind of got Frieza's interest and then they started to work together. So in that particular timeline, Frieza and Cheelai basically just became almost like, you know, company for each other. So that's been my standout favorite. And episode 7, just seeing how, just that moment where she just like is sickened by Saiyans. Because in the What If, I had moments where she just did not trust Goku, did not trust any Saiyan at all. And Frieza's just like, well, you know, you're not wrong exactly. You know, Saiyans back in the day were really bad. And just that scene where, you know, Cheelai's extremely upset and like Yamcha's just like, you know, seriously, I'm sorry. And the pep talk that Frieza gives is, I know you meant well, but don't talk about that again, will you? Just that moment, that really struck a chord with me. So I'd say probably most of episode 7 was really something for me.
Yeah, I'd love to kind of follow off of that. You know, Yamcha, a lot of his life experience, at least in the series, is, you know, Dragon Ball has its share of serious moments, but it's ultimately very lighthearted, and even death gets treated with like, you know, death is bad, but we have a solution to that. So dealing with on a larger scale, things like genocide, you know, in front of him, I think a lot of the problem is that Yamcha does come from this very, I want to say sheltered, because he's been on the verge of planetary destruction and so on. But compared to the stuff that Frieza's been involved with for so long, I mean, that's been a big part of Yamcha's arc. As far as his experiences and trying to talk Cheelai out of her, you know, Saiyan-oriented prejudice, you know, that's been a big part of it for me. And just trying to have him reconcile, you know, his life experience. Hey, come on, I'm friends with Goku. He's great. Please. Oh, I have no grounds to talk about this experience. But, you know, beyond that, it's... you know, I really appreciate, and the moments for me are when I realize as I'm going through the script with you or beforehand, I realize, wait a minute. Oh, my God, this is a reference that shows that you really know your stuff when you guys are writing it. And it shows how much love you have for the series. And so when it's a little reference or a nod to something that's not super important in Dragon Ball or Z or Super or whatever, but it's there. And it's something that you paid attention to and incorporated into the story. And it's just, I think it really goes a long way at creating that authenticity and making it a very believable story. Also, just having that character dynamic between each of them, because they are all so very different. And Yamcha being somewhere without Puar as well, giving Yamcha more of a chance to just be himself, going through these different scenarios. And yeah, him being the second strongest person on the ship, that is kind of a big deal. It's been a long time since that's ever happened, so that's awesome for fans alike. Certainly one of my favorite things to read in the comments is when people talk about just how glad I'm really Yamcha attached, you might notice. So when people talk about Yamcha getting his day in the sun and how happy they are about it. And, you know, obviously there are a lot of Yamcha fans out there. So it's just kind of a consistent thing. And I'm sure if you ask at some point what we want to see, you're going to hear the same thing I always tell you every time we talk about this. I want the long hair back. I want long-haired Bandit back.
Well, usually with every season of like Star Trek: The Next Generation, they usually like have a group photo, and I can trust you that the next season will have slightly longer hair.
Yeah,
well, definitely, a man can dream. Sure. Yeah, and also there's just things that have reminds me of. It's like for episode 10, and this was like the Riker episode where he cooks for everybody, and everyone's like, "What is this? Why are you cooking? Why?" And in this one, it's actually a not so well-known fact that Yamcha actually is a good cook and have reminded me of it. So I was like, hey, for this first parter, why don't we just have this where Yamcha's like, well, I'm kind of bored with this, you know, regeneration stuff. I'm just going to cook something for myself, you know, with what we have. And we just had it that actually he's really, really good. And that everybody was just like, completely made themselves immobile for the first time of not actually having processed food in like months.
So tasty.
Cooking mama.
Yeah. I think one of the coolest thing about Yamcha and Cheelai in this series is like the banter between them. I don't know how about you, Mas, but like it's so organic when you write it. Like when you have those two, like the lines just pop into your head. Like
yeah, that's what I love about writing characters, just giving them the banter. They just like it just flows. And if I'm on a really good roll, I can write an episode in about like 2.5 hours. If I'm on a good roll. Like, as in, like, just, like, I love, you know, characters who, you know, talk with each other. It just works. And Cheelai and Yamcha, they do it, it's easy. It's really easy.
Their dynamic is very, very, you know, natural and organic. Yeah. And, like, I'm never stuck, you know, what to write for them, you know?
Mm. Hey, Julia, what's been your standout moment, you know, in general?
Well, I guess, well, before that, I kind of wanted to follow up on also just kind of, like, I guess all the character dynamics and like how Frieza, despite, you know, the series being, oh, what if Frieza turned good? Isn't exactly good in the traditional sort of sense, especially with the season finale and how that ends up clashing with someone like Yamcha, who is on that, you know, usual very good Paragon sort of side. Hey, he's not really that good. You can see where he's coming from, but feel free to question his motives. Sort of a thing.
Yeah, and yeah. Exactly. In episode 4, there is the quote that a lot of people remember. It's like, I may have changed my ways, but that doesn't necessarily mean that I am a nice guy.
Mm.
As in, like, you know, I may not destroy your planet, but I'm not necessarily going to be your best buddy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like because, like, with the, you know, original What If series concluded, it's not the end of Frieza's moral journey. Like, it's still going.
Yeah.
To be honest, it started in the What If, and it goes through in Revelation F, more or less. Like, he's kind of new in this non-evil stuff, so... honestly, like, we should rename this What If series to What If Frieza Turned Better.
Yeah, that would be more technically accurate, but he does end up being the good guy per se, yeah. More like an anti-hero or an anti-villain or something like that.
He slid to the neutral alignment, mm-hmm. And he's working toward good.
Yeah. Mm. Okay, so we'll stick to this. Favorite line. Favorite line of any of y'all, so just... shout out.
Hello, brother. Good to see you.
Yes. Episode 12. Just that moment. It's just like, yeah, because Stan played one of the envoys in episode 6, but it was just, that was like done properly. As in, right, like, that's how a Frigidarian's meant to talk.
If I was actually to be a Frigidarian.
Yeah, exactly. So in this one, it had to be Yamcha trying to do it badly, but that works anyway.
That was probably my favorite thing about that. Just the fact that, yes, like, I did record with you an actual, you know, proper version of what one would sound like. And then now here's having to balance, how do I make Yamcha sound like it? But it's still Yamcha. You know, that was so that definitely, I've been thinking about that one since we recorded it. It's so funny to me. Hearing it in the premiere as well, I was having a blast.
Yeah, no, that was really good. Just the fact that it worked and Cheelai's disbelief of like, oh my
I love
God,
that
I
so
have been
much.
Training all my life to be stealthy, and this is what it takes to get somewhere? What?
Level 0.
Yes.
Oh, I mean, now that Stanpai's brought it up, like, just the whole, oh, this is a level 0 mission, why am I here? It was amazing. I mean, you heard me. I was laughing. I was cackling when I first read that.
Yeah, and then when Cheelai was like, his name is Hunter. Just like, that was just Cheelai trying her best. It worked, but, you know.
She's dying on the inside.
I've had a few breakdowns during the recording sessions. Even when I've already read the script, when we're getting through it, you know, I've had to cut from my audio a lot of laughter. When I deliver my audio, it's like, okay, now let's remove this section where I couldn't stop chuckling about it.
Oh, I remember those sequences very much so. Yeah, because that's the whole point with this series was just to, like, well, as this series continues. I can imagine this being like four seasons easily, but we've just finished season one. But the whole point of this series is just to be a bit of fun. Just a bit of fun. Yeah, a bit of a romp throughout space. You know, this can be, yeah, we can do like some more things that we can't necessarily do in a what if. Yeah, we can actually take our time with some things. We can have some lighthearted episodes. We can establish some lore that, you know, works because space is really big. Yeah. So you can incorporate things from Dragon Ball if you wanted to, but we're trying not to do that because, I mean, for Hav and I, our ultimate goal is to have a truly original series in about a couple of years' time. So that's what we want to do. And R&R was one stepping stone. Is one stepping stone, as in, like, you know, setting it in a Dragon Ball scenario, but with some original characters. This one, Revelation F, is mostly original characters with some ones from Dragon Ball that people recognize, Cheelai, right. Yamcha, all that stuff. But there'll be one more step, but that'll be coming soon. So this has been really good because we've made things like, sure, we've developed the Zunians and stuff like that. But we've also made the Grass Bobs, which will pretty much be the rival species to Frieza outside of the Frigidarians. Our Klingons, basically.
Oh, yeah. And I was even voicing one, which was like, you know, like, I don't have a very wide range of voices and my accent kind of limits me, but that was a lot of fun.
No, definitely. I think it's because Hav and I both, I voice one of the hunters and he voices the shaman, and we'll find out the shaman's name in the next season. And I'm definitely looking forward to hopefully Grass Bob Huntress Queen.
Something I really like about this, all just this production in general, is you know, you can also see your love for other series in the way that, especially series involving traveling through space on adventures every day. I remember, you know, my exposure to Star Trek and whatnot is very limited, and during an episode I remember you gave me so this is a parallel to so-and-so in Star Trek, and that's what this is, and this is like a nod, and I was like, oh wow, you know, I didn't know that. But I really appreciate getting to see tributes to things that you love when people write stuff, and so having that aspect, I think you really you're melding these two different things together by giving us that with, you know, Dragon Ball on one hand and then all the stuff that influences you guys on the other.
Well, thank you. But yeah, I'm relatively new to Star Trek. I watched Star Trek Discovery to begin with, just to get myself into the lore. I'd always seen Star Trek on TV, and it was something that just slipped me by. I was more of a Red Dwarf person and Hitchhikers, you know, British stuff, like maybe a little bit of Blake Seven here and now and again. That's why there's tons of Hitchhikers and references to Red Dwarf all there. But I've been watching The Next Generation. I've just finished season 3. And it's been really good for helping write episodes. Like, it's the episode where Data...
Measure of a Man.
Measure of a Man. It's Something of a Man. I remember that. That is the Shiraz episode. And that was like, I mean, it's almost becoming it almost became a joke to me, like, oh, this episode, is this going to be an episode where Shiraz may die at this point? Because it happens like 3 times. Yeah. Like, potentially you think, oh no, Shiraz is going to be Kaputsky.
People got really emotional about this episode. So
they really did. And that's the best thing. Like, as Hav pointed out to me, if you want people to hate a character, you make them either endanger a fan favorite or kill them. And yeah, nobody likes Langu after that.
If there are no puppies around to endanger, then pick one of the favorites.
pick the sentient smart aleck computer, who's basically sort of insane.
What I want to say about Langu, I don't want to defend his behavior, but like, we may find out where he's coming from in the future and why he is the way he is about AIs.
Oh yeah, but for now, hate him with every single gun.
Yeah, oh, hate him.
Oh, for now, oh, hate him, detest him, loathe him. Just for now. There'll be more to it. Again, season one was about just establishing the predicament, having Frigid in there, seeing where it goes. And I'm looking forward because, yeah, it may turn out that Frigid may not be the only clone out there.
Also, one thing that I think is pretty nice about, you know, Revelation F, and I don't know if you all will agree with me, but the way it is framed is that you can present it to a non-Dragon Ball person, right, and they still will have fun.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah, that's the point. It's meant to be something that, okay, there are these characters from Dragon Ball, but you don't need to learn much about Dragon Ball. It's just a story in its own right. And yes, there have been loads of standout things that have just happened by chance. I mean, when I introduced General Magnet in episode 9, we hadn't written 12 yet. And Magnet in that is essentially the orchestrator of the Frigidarians for the longest time. And of course, it's named after a fridge magnet. So there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, things. There's like, oh, Chester and drawers are Chester drawers, pretty much. Like, yeah, just, yeah, a dresser or something like that. And Lieutenant Crispa is the Crispa drawer. So yeah, how like fridges have Crispa drawers and stuff like that. I love coming up with names from the Dragon Ball world because it's just fantastic. And there are just so many good ones. Like Ugpla is just plug. As in just a general plug.
One of those things that I think is also special about your naming conventions is that you're over the pond. So you have different household items or names for household items than a lot of us do in the West. And then like the, you know, the US West.
Oh, the so West West.
Enough. Yeah.
The westiest of Wests.
No, it's been a really interesting ride. And I'm glad that you two are with us as part of the main core group. And it's been really good having the likes of Jukai. And now we introduce Otios back in. Yeah. And that Otios is going to be an interesting character to follow because inadvertently, Cheelai has something to do with his return.
Oh.
So, yeah. As in, like, all the stuff she said in episode 5 meant something.
Wink, wink, nudge, nudge.
I'm just leaving loads of tidbits for you all because I know that people are keen to find out more because everyone at episode 12 was just like, you can't just stop it there.
But we did.
Yeah, we did. Yeah.
Well, like, oh, must have. You could just have it like a, give it like a conclusion. But we didn't. That's the point, people. That's the point.
That's to make you watch.
Hang on that clip and like it.
Not pulling a not going to pull a Twin Peaks here and end it on season 2 with a total, like, no conclusion for 20 years, you know?
No, exactly. No, we're not doing that.
We're not doing that. And basically, the final scene is basically maybe not written, but conceptualized.
Oh, yes. No, we have conceptualized potentially the ending of the entire thing. It's I feel like it's good to, like, that means the journey, in theory, will be perpetual. But we'll leave it at that. Yeah. So, yeah, I think all remains to be said is, like, what would you two, Julia, Stan, what would you like to see for your characters going into future seasons? I know that, Stan, you said but having longer hair. That's,
well, long
that's
hair.
That's yes, I know. That doesn't count. Go on.
Let me type long hair. Long flowing hair. Okay.
Well, I mean, we touched on, I guess, I mean, Cheelai being a lot younger here and her general demeanor towards, like, Saiyans and everything. I kind of want to see her, like, I want to see her mature and, like, her world expand, especially with the people that she's, you know, hanging out with, like, Yamcha. You know, Yamcha, the one who's friends with, like, Goku and Broly and all them. Yeah, not necessarily, like, she, you know, is just like, oh, suddenly everything is fine. She's totally chilled all of them. Just, like, understanding more of the world instead of holding on to, like, the past.
We do touch upon Nyera being out there. I think it's safe to say that, you know, Nyera is going to turn up properly in the series.
And it's funny you mentioned that because we talked about, like, you know, what direction we want to take Cheelai in as Cheelai, not only, you know, as related to her sister, but as a character as a whole. So we had that discussion like 2 days ago or something.
No, definitely. We've got plans. We've got plenty of plans. And I think that should appeal. But yeah, Stan, did you have one that wasn't about long hair?
I do. So, you know, something that you've talked about before as one of those big issues for Yamcha's abuse from Toriyama is, like, his dreams of things like having a family, the one thing that he wanted in life, you know, to. And so on one hand, having a hope of a future that's brighter than the one that's, you know, back on Earth, but also Just him facilitating that role as somebody who can be the good guy in a bad world. Space has proven many times over to be morally ambiguous and a great danger. So for him to kind of preserve that innocence that comes from being a heroic Earthling and maybe spread some of that good around the galaxy, continuing to do what we're doing while also, you know, getting caught up in shenanigans, but ultimately being that moral compass for his friends and seeing that goodness prevail despite the challenges ahead. So yeah, more exploration of the galaxy where he can also be a hero character and do so without consequence of death.
No, don't worry. We can assure you that won't happen.
Yeah, request. Don't kill Yamcha.
Yeah, Yamcha
isn't. Don't kill any of them. Actually,
yeah, you're not fair.
Well, certainly. Well, we won't kill Yamcha yet. No, don't worry. I think we can
tell our audience that there is already a Yamcha themed episode for season 2.
Yes, and we got a good cameo for that, so that's going to be fun.
Yeah,
that'll be good fun when we realize that. But yeah, I think all that remains to be said is thank you so much, you two, for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, exactly. It's been amazing being a part of this.
And I'm pretty sure that we will be doing more episodes, like maybe just like some, you know, looking back at season 2, perhaps. But we'll be having you back on, I'm pretty sure. But yeah. I think that all remains to be said now is thank you out there for listening to the special Revelation Air podcast. If you haven't had a chance to listen to it, you can find the playlist on YouTube. You can find the audiobook on Spotify, Apple Music, and all good streaming services. Or you can check out our podcast feed right here for all 12 episodes thus far and have a sit down. And I'm pretty sure you'll have a good time. I mean, we had a good time writing it and performing in it. And it's certainly been really good. So thank you all out there for listening. And we shall see you again for the next episode. Take care, everybody.